Good evening, all the participants. We are now playing ICI motto song. I request all the participants to put their right hand on their heart. Dear friends, as we are moving forward on this third day of our webinar series in GST audit, now I request our dynamic chairman, under whose leadership we are able to unlock this lockdown, to CA Fanil Shah, chairman of Ahmedabad branch. And we are having today's learned faculty, I can say permanent faculty for GST audit season, Venu Kela. CA Fanil Shah, sir.
Yes. Thank you, Bishun bhai. The speaker of the third day of the second series, CA Venu Gopal Gillaji from Bangalore, the chairmen of various other branches of Gujarat joining with us, the chairman of Indirect Tax Committee, CA Rahul Maliwal, the secretary of the branch, CA Bishun Shah, and all the members attending from all over the India, I welcome you all to this third day of this GST webinar series. Just friends, nothing more to say today. Just a few updates with respect to programs being organized by branch. Now friends, today this GST webinar series, apart from this, now all the programs that are going to be organized now in this week to come are something new and different. That is, we are starting with an international taxation series tomorrow morning. We are starting with that. So if you have yet not registered, kindly take the benefit of that. We are having, except one speaker, we are having all the speakers from out of India, I mean out of Gujarat, sorry, and all are expert in their own fields. Moreover, if you are interested to become an independent director, then what are the nitty-gritties with respect to that? With respect to that, we are having a session on Friday. Also, we are having a session tomorrow with respect to trademarks, which is also one of the very important one. And one more important session on payment gateways on this particular Thursday. Even there are few more interesting programs in pipeline, but I'm not announcing right now because yet they are to be launched. But soon I come up with that also. So I wish you a happy learning in this particular lockdown. And now I would request Rahul ji to kindly introduce the faculty and take the session.
Thank you so much, Chairman sir. Good evening to everyone. Welcome you all on the third day of this particular series. The topic of the today's session is the GST annual audit, and that is also the liability part under the 9C. The faculty for the session is the Venu Gopal sir. We all know him very well. He is a cool, calm, composed and highly intellectual person. He secured 45th rank in CA examination. He has delivered so many lectures on the GST at various professional forum. He has authored so many books with regard to the GST. At the same time, he also contributed to the technical guide issued by the ICAI on GST audit. He was the co-opted member for the IDT committee ICAI for 2018 and 19. At the same time, he is the techno-savvy main and the delivering various lectures in the corporates on the use of the technology. And at last, I want to say for questions, you please put your question up to 6:15 so that we can compile the same. Now, thank you so much. Now I'll request Venu sir to take the session forward.
Very good evening, friends. And I'm sure everyone are at home safe. And definitely in this season, there are a lot of webinars are happening. Sometimes some of you would be confused to which webinar to attend, but make sure that you move forward, schedule yourself, do your office work, continue our learning. And once we are back from this lockdown and when we go back, we would have a lot of office work to be handled. So it is definitely required that we take care of our own learning and our people learning. Yeah. And one thing which we have also learned because of this lockdown is life can actually move on, not going to office. There are some areas which we can actually do at home. And one of the area which people can do sitting at home is preparing GST annual returns, GST audits. So the quantity of time which is required being at office or the client place is definitely less. In fact, I know some of the offices are actually considering 30% of their staff to be at home. To that extent, the risk for them is also reduced and the risk of contacting others also reduced, at least 1 year till we have a vaccine. So today's session on the GST audit, I'm sure the Ahmedabad branch has got definitely good speakers, and I've looked at the materials of the last 2 days. You definitely got enriched with GSTR 9 preparation. Now today I'm going to deal about GSTR 9C outward related supplies and nitty-gritties relating to it. I am making one assumption that at least most of you are aware of the provisions of the law. You have already conducted GST audits. You know GSTR 9 and 9C filling. So I'm not getting into the overview of any of that information. So we will get into the issues. In fact, if you have pen and paper, I would recommend make as much notes as you think of different clients or what are the areas you would miss out in doing audits during the discussion. So that definitely it would be helpful in putting questions when you are doing the audits. So moving to the session, the background of the audit under GST, the term audit which is defined in the GST, if you look at 2 subsection 13, the word audit is being defined as examination of records, returns and other documents maintained or furnished by the taxable person under this act or rules made thereunder or any other law. Time being in force, we'll come to it, especially when the search seizure happens. But why is it done? In order to verify the correctness of turnover declared, taxes paid, refund claim, input tax credit availed. Predominantly these 4. Please make a note of it, because when we look at the 9C form, they have beautifully drafted considering exactly the same thing, and also to assess the overall compliance with the provisions of the act or rules made thereunder. This is what an expectation of an audit is. Whether a department officer is doing an audit under section 65 or you are doing an audit under rule 80 section 44 related thing, whenever you are doing it, this is what a broader overview. Let's see how 9C form has been drafted. In fact, GSTR 9C is similar to our tax audit report. In our tax audit report under income tax, we have 3CD and 3CA or 3CB. The predominant work is there in 3CD, and of course the risk comes in whatever the certificate which we give. Likewise, in 9C we have 2 parts: part A, a reconciliation statement; part B, a certification statement. And when we say reconciliation statement, it is something reconciling with the returns. What is it reconciling with the returns? Books of accounts reconciling with the returns. And in my view, as an auditor view, if there is any liability which you would want to capture and report, that is a liability we qualify and quantify. Then we give a certificate, and like 3CA, 3CB, if you are the auditor, financial auditor and GST auditor is same, like how you will issue 3CA, here you will be issuing part B1. If the auditor or 2 auditors are different, you will be choosing B2, like 3CB. So more or less the in tax audit, the procedural aspects, how you notice is the same way they have designed the form. Now we have seen the definition of 9C. Keep that in mind. While you do the GST audit, you look at the following 2 things. 1, audited financial statements. to GST R9. So you look at only the following two things. You look at GST R9 and the auditor financial statements. These are the two critical things. In fact, for the purpose of GST audit, there is some background noise coming in. Is there? Yeah. Okay. The noise.
Then now it is done now.
Yeah. Okay. So while doing your GST audit 9C, you have got nothing to do to check 1, 3B or any of those. All that you will be looking at is SSE has acknowledged this as his liability, like GST R9 as his income tax return kind. And there are books of accounts. So you are looking at what should be the liability basis which the SSE has finalized. If you are satisfied with the liability, absolutely no responsibility, no other liability, it is well and fine. So your scope of the audit is restricted to audited financials, books of accounts with some adjustments which we will look into. Now, I am not getting into each and every table of GST or 9C because by now you would have seen the form, but I'm going to give a macro view and only the technical issues under 9C outward liability related. Very beautifully drafted form which is there in five parts. Part one is always basic information. Generally, you look at what? The turnover. You validate the turnover, total turnover and exempted turnover in part two, table 5 to table 8. You reconcile the taxes in table 9, 10, 11 and input tax credit in part 4. Owing to all this, if you find there is any additional liability, you report it in your part 5, right? If I have to logically explain how this has been derived, the objective of the audit, what is the objective of the audit, is to ensure, whether it is department audit or a GST audit, to ensure the compliance is done with the law. And when we say compliance with the done with the law, what is that we are expecting? Whether the proper taxes have been paid or not. Whether the proper taxes have been paid or not. Now, if I have to give a mathematical formula, or if you have to explain to your kid, how do you compute tax? The definition of that would be, your tax liability is always equal to gross liability minus input tax credit, right? And forward charge, reverse charge. So liability minus input tax credit. How do you get your liability? Liability, we say turnover multiplied by rate of tax. Liability, we say as turnover multiplied by rate of tax. Now, how do I, do I multiply with the total turnover? Definitely no. We multiply only with the taxable turnover. When I say turnover, it is only taxable turnover. And how do I get my taxable turnover? Total turnover, aggregate turnover minus exempted turnover. Aggregate turnover minus exempted turnover. And when I say ITC, what we are talking is eligible input tax credit. This is how one will quantify a liability mean. Liability means gross liability minus input tax credit. Form is also beautifully drafted the same way. So I want to assess taxable turnover, but for which I need to check aggregate turnover and reduce exempted turnover. We start with the table 5, we look at aggregate turnover. We derive what should be the turnover of the SSE vis-a-vis what he is claiming as his turnover. 5N of GST R9, we compare with all the line items. So 5Q, we come up with all the various things. And if there is a difference, then we will give that difference explanation in table 6, right? So we reconcile my aggregate turnover, and if there is any difference, we give it in table 6. Now, if the aggregate turnover is matching, fine. There might be a situation where the turnover you have derived versus the turnover which SSE has derived is perfect, but just that he has claimed something as exemptions. So not an aggregate turnover, you will also test for exemptions. You will also test for exemption. So whether the exempted turnover is matching or not, what according to you is exempted turnover, you will report it in table 7. You will compare with what SSE has claimed in table 5. Now, if it is matching, well and fine. Otherwise, you will give the difference in table 8. So you have derived your turnover, which is taxable turnover. Now, my liability is turnover multiplied with the rate of tax. Maybe your turnover and the SSE turnover is matching, but the rate of tax did not match. He would have taken the rate of tax as 12%. In your view, rate of tax is 18%. So you compute your liability and you will take the liability calculation in table 9. If there is a mismatch in the liability of yours and SSE, you will report it in table 10. And lastly, you will create a liability, maybe because of turnover mismatch or rate related liability mismatch. In your table 11, you list out what is a liability which is arising on account of outward supply. An account of outward supply, this is what you are going to consider. Now, table 12 onwards is on input tax credit. Our other learned faculty will be taking tomorrow. Now, while doing the audit, what is that you should be mindful of is your audit working papers. How did you arrive these values? So are there any adjustments of the prior period? Now, there could be a situation in table 10 of GSTR9, as you all know by now. In last year, I have said in table 10 that so much of my tax liability I did not pay and I have paid. So while filing GSTR 9C for 18-19, whatever the summation of 3B, please note summation of 3B for 18-19, you got to reduce that much amount of the tax which is disclosed in table 10 of last year, because SSE has acknowledged that I did not pay in 17-18 and I have paid in 18-19. Given that the taxes have been paid in subsequent year, you got to reduce that. So you got to make your prior period adjustments. You got to check whether HSN classifications have been done correctly or not. There might be credits that are there in the PN, but sometimes these credits are there to PL in an expenditure side which is hidden. You got to check for it. You got to check for valuation also. So you got to check various items. So hereinafter, I will be explaining you what are the issues that would come up in outward supplies and what is that you should have to take care of it. One of it is also time of supply and advances. So from now on, I will be taking what are the various issues that you might be encountering during the GST audit, given that you have done audits in the earlier period. So you might be familiar with various issues that I am bringing up. Those who are well versed with the subject, you can consider this as a revision, or so there would be some of the points you might have not considered in the audit. You can take care of it. So I have classified various issues for the purpose of our discussion into this method. There is a small typo: general issues, accounting related issues, issues that arise in on account of incomplete records. There are what are the missing data controls in the audit. Now, what are the primary general issues? Most of the times, you might do the GST audit for the entity as such. Most of the time, you are doing GST audit for the entity as such. The entity as such, when you are doing, you will face two kinds of problem. Either books of accounts is completely consolidated. For three states together, they have one books of accounts. You have a challenge in segregating. For the purpose of income tax, it's a PAN-based audit, so you have happily done. Segregating that consolidated books of accounts would be challenging. Sometimes you might be doing an audit for some of the states. Say you got an audit of, say, Reliance Petrochemical and ECRO, which is present across India, or Infosys, who is present. So big companies who are present across India, you might be doing an audit of their any one division or in any one of the states. While you are doing the audit, what you are doing is from the PAN-based to a state-based, which is a GISTIN-based. Your start point in your 5A, your start point in 5A is carved out financials. Now, how do you justify to yourself that the start point is correct? Because you have an audited financials, which is 10,000 crores, and what you are certifying is 25 crores. Now, Likewise, there are auditors across India who is doing the audits. How can you consolidate it all and say that it is matching 10,000 crores? There is no way track of that exists. But you are signing it. So how do you ascertain to yourself that your start point is correct? Your 25 crores, which you are saying start point is correct, is very much important. So you definitely got to get a representation from the management and a certified trial balance, which are FIN P&L, split into GST and vice. The audited financials definitely got to be split into GST and vice. Now you may get a question sometime about other income, miscellaneous income, scrap or dividend income, which is recognized in the corporate office. Where do I account? Whichever the GST and ID management wants to account for it, let them account it. But the point is, audited P&L has to start with a segregation into GST based financials. Next, the unreconciled GST are 9 and books. Most of the times you will also face this issue. When the GST R9 is prepared by the SSE himself. Now there are times where the auditor undertakes the engagement of preparing GST R9 and 9C, right? So there you have the data, you are in control of the data. But sometimes the auditor do not engage that aspect. Technically, our role in the audit is only 9C. Like, we cannot be an author of the books and an auditor of the books. But we may assist them in doing the right way of doing things. Now, when you are assisting in right way of doing, no, you have control of the data. But they have done and they come back, they have come to you. When you ask them on what basis you are, can you give me the breakup of it? They might not have it. So it is very much necessary before even you start the audit, ask them to produce GST R9, ask them to produce carved out financials. And very importantly, the stock registers, right? So there are stocks which is maintained in different godowns which are not registered as place of business. So closing stock would also play a crucial role, especially when there are multiple locations outside the state. Because how will you know the inter-unit transactions have been properly ascertained and watched for? The last challenge in the general issue, sometimes we rely upon the accounting reports. We try to extract the data from accounting. We cannot read the whole of the financial statements and dump. We may go to the financial statement software and from there we rely on the statutory reports which are generated by those softwares. If the configuration is not done well, you will have an issue. So these are the general issues that come up. Let's actually get into subject issues. Technical issues that will come up and what are the things you have to be you have to consider while validating the turnover. First, treatment in the earlier loss. You know, in the earlier loss you have some treatment. According to it, it is not taxable, or according to it, this means it. No, that is still continued. Given that there is an audit which happened for 1 year, maybe if you are doing audit for the first time, you have to definitely necessarily to do one thing with the client is prepare a preamble document. What does the preamble document should talk about? It should talk about whatever you are seeing in this slide. It should talk about what is their nature of business and how they were treating in the earlier law and how are they treating currently. Owing to this nature of business, What according to them is their classification. Firstly, are they into supply of goods or supply of service? If goods, what is the HSN? What is the rate of tax? And to who are their customers? How many of them are related party? How many of them are not related party? In case of related party, what is the mechanism of the valuation which they are exercising? Have they prepared a SOP? And most of them, there is an implementation study which would have been done at the time of GST. Have they prepared an SOP as to how to do the transaction effect of time of supply or classification valuation? Have they prepared any of that? So the first and foremost, you got to prepare a preamble document. And if the understanding in the nature of the company, if you feel that they have, say, barter transactions, if they have some exchange, they are giving some exchange of the other transactions. So looking at the nature of the industry, you got to do little more research and list out what are the relevant notifications that have come, what are the time to time rate of taxes which have changed. Today information is available on the internet, you can get it. Next, since you are not the author of annual return, the taxpayer is the author of the annual return. There is one last chance for the taxpayer to correct in the annual return. We all know annual return is an informative return. In the annual return, you definitely cannot put a new liability if it is not paid. You cannot do a reversal. Only if something is which is missed out, you know there is a DRC03 annual return. And DRC03, there are many DRC03s. Only DRC03, which is related as annual return, can come into the annual return, leaving that nothing else can come into the annual return. So the responsibility to correct is first given to the taxpayer using the DRC03 annual return. Otherwise, there is no other mechanism to correct anything in the annual return. He can correct everything and complete the things voluntarily. And what you are responsible for is the reconciliation statement. You are the author of reconciliation statement. So you have onus. You have onus over and above what he has said, that okay, I have cleared up all my sins, I have paid all my taxes. Here is what my final statement is when your role starts in. So you got to explain if there are any differences with the audited financials. You cannot say that, okay, I did not find any difference. If you do not find any difference, you got to reason out why you did not find any difference. You cannot just say that like nil, right? Where are your working papers to say that, yes, it is nil? So between table 5A to 5O, you will be putting various numbers, starting with your audited financials. What is your working papers? Unbilled revenue opening, unbilled revenue closing, where are your working papers? Wherever you are saying opening unbilled revenue, is that number matching with the previous year number? You know, it could be situation where that in the previous year I have reduced a substantial amount saying as unbilled revenue, saying that revenue is there in the books of accounts, I did not raise an invoice, and I reduced the closing unbilled revenue. This year, when the time comes to add it to my opening unbilled revenue, I chose a different figure, right? You would be into a risk. So you have to pay attention to whether right or wrong. What is the number which has been adopted in the last year? What was the closing advances? What is the closing unbilled revenue? What was the number they have adopted? You definitely have to pay attention to it and bring that as the information. Now, whenever an information is not disclosed, see, from the perspective of department, it would be treated as suppression and any recovery would be treated under Section 74, right? Especially these transactions which do not involve cash, even you do not know, right? As an auditor, I enter into a barter transaction with a client saying, I will do a bookkeeping services to you. You provide a rental space for me, for my staff to sit, and I will be using one of your premises. Now, neither in my books nor his books, there are any accounting entries. How do we cull out these transactions when there are free supplies given, where there is a subscriptions given? So certain things you got to, that is where the preamble document comes into your place and helps you. Please refer to notes to accounts, and sometimes they are very handy. Next, in terms of reporting of turnover in table 5, you got to report all the turnover. You have to report all the turnover, whether there is a GST or non-GST, whether it is exempted, taxable, non-taxable, whatever it is, you got to compare with all the turnover. So your starting point 5A would be sales plus direct income plus indirect income. You will be whatever on the face of the PL account, whatever on the face of PL account, which you are seeing as income, take it. Now, you may ask me the question, what about which is there as a credit side to the expenditure? Can I put it under 5A? In my personal view, put it as another adjustments and take it. Let the starting point 5A match with the face of the PL, whether taxable, not taxable. Anything which you think is non-taxable would anyhow you will reduce it in table 7 to derive the taxable income. But please make sure your start point is with all the line items, right? And especially whenever the GST auditor or the department auditor, GST authorities are calling for the scrutiny, it is immediately available and it is matching. So as an auditor, because most of the time the field work is done by the staff. So when they bring the working papers, you just put yourself as a reviewer and at a macro level, is it matching or not? Then you start adding these credits which are there in the expenditure account. Add those things. So from the part of the audit, build your questionnaire as to how are they recording it. Scrutinize every item in your balance sheet, like your debtors, if there are any advances. If you go to your whole list of debtors, there are something on debit side, something on the credit side. It got netted off and presented to the financials. But whatever which is there on the credit side, it comes as an addition because time of supply would have arisen unless otherwise it is for goods. So for services, it is still there for advances. So you cull it out. Sometimes it would have parked in the current liabilities. So today businesses are creative and however the businessman would have grouped it. So make note of all those kind of transactions. Sometimes some expenditure is treated as a pure agent, completely knocked off. For example, I am renting my premises. Along with the rent, I collect water bill, electricity, and everything. I pay to the government. So rental income I show to the P&L. These other charges which I collect, I offset into my balance sheet, park it into current liability, and from there I will pay it off. And some may argue saying that, okay, it is a pure agent. Section rule 33, pure agent is very clear that it has to satisfy certain conditions and most likely it doesn't get satisfied. So you also got to verify and scrutinize the line items which are there in the current liability. Next, the turnover includes the supplies for consideration in non-monetary. In non-monetary, and especially your inter-unit transactions, your barter transaction, the promotion schemes. We have a circular, I think circular 105 or we got for discounts, which is later they got rescinded, but a beautifully drafted circular one has to lay hands on. What types of our income which can be considered as the supplies where you, the promotional discounts are given, are a true credit note and what cannot be a true credit note. Here, let's take one small example in case of a promotional discounts. Let's take the example of mobile phones. Let's take the example of mobile phones. I have a small retail outlet. I have a small retail outlet. I'm selling mobile phones. Now, I buy phones from the distributors and I'm selling. Suddenly, distributor is giving some credit notes. And think everything is a financial credit note. Like if it is a GST credit note, definitely my input tax credit reduced. It is a credit note which is given. Now, credit note, two types of accounting possible. One would show under credit side of the PL as another income. Others may show net it off my expenditure because it is given by my distributor. It would have shown. In either case, it is an aspect to be considered. Should I need to pay GST on this income? Now, the mobile store says, see, I did not do any supply. He has given a credit note. Why did he give a credit note? It is scheme discount, incentive, various names they would be giving. Suddenly, new phone has come. Like Samsung launched new, they say, okay, place all these boxes in the front line. I'll give you some discount. Or the new phone has come, iPhone 12 has come, iPhone 11 is getting faded out from 1.1 lakh. Suddenly the price is slashed to say 70,000. I myself has purchased at 80,000. Now I have to sell at 70,000. I would as well give it back to my super stockist or the distributor and say, take it back. very nice. It's okay, you keep it. I will give you 10,000 rupees as scheme incentive. Now, all this gets clubbed and come to you as an incentive. So you have to identify there are some discounts. Only the discounts which have attributed owing to your purchases, bulk volume purchased. You have purchased so much of the volume. He has given 1%, 2% additional commission or additional rebate, which he has computed and given as a credit note at the year end. Leaving that rest, all credit notes are taxable, and you got to be very careful when these credit notes. So whatever the line item which is coming into table 7 of 9C, anything coming into table 7 of 9C, you have to mandatorily call for extra documentation and prove that yes, okay, this deserves a value in table 7. You know, whatever in table 5, you are looking for the totality. In table 7, whenever it is being filled, you are excluding it. So please be careful whenever the transactions are kept away in table 7. Sometimes the transactions relating to outside the taxable territory are not reported. So take a cognizance of what are the transactions you are keeping outside the reporting. Next, the liability, the matching concept. In accounts, we have a matching concept. Income and expenses have to be matched in the same period. But when it comes to the GST, when it relating to supply, a supply of 1819, if reported in 1920, still it is a supply of 1819. When it comes to an input tax credit, a credit of 1819 when reported in 1920, it becomes a credit of 1920. So liability dates back to the original date it belongs to. Credit dates to the date when it has been taken. And when I say liability belongs to the date back when it belongs to, not just the financial year, even the months. You know, most of the times I also notice that we get ourselves satisfied looking at the macro picture. Okay, total got matched. What if the customer has reported all the totals in the last quarter? He has avoided the interest. So you also have to do now an extra mile. You have to do this extra mile of identifying what is this taxable turnover according to you to be paid in each of the month. And I see in most of the, sometimes there are a lot of people who comes to me saying that, okay, this is what I have done and I'm going to finalize. Just give me a glance and say. And what I notice missing is the liability calculation month on month. The client, the auditor forgets to compute this liability month on month and compute the interest. The question is always there whether the interest to be paid on gross or net. And it was law debated a lot. And in my personal view, from the beginning, I took a stand that it is payable on the net. And but still, you got to compute. And especially when there is an omission to file an invoice, it cannot defer the tax liability. You got to take care of it. What is one thing which generally people miss out is credit notes. Now, a strict reading of the law, reading of Section 34. For it to be a valid credit note, of course, it has to fulfill the conditions of 34. Apart from that, it has to be reported in GSTR 1. A strict reading of the law, if it is not reported in GSTR 1, even though client has issued a credit note, the other person has reduced input tax credit, well, technically we can't vouch for it, but even though it is strictly satisfying all the conditions, goods got returned and I issued credit note, just forgot to report it in GSTR 1. Now, a literal reading of the law, if it is not reported in the GSTR 1 by September of the next financial year, it is not a valid credit note. So to that extent, even though if you are not creating a liability, you have to make a qualification point in the audit report. You got to take it. Next, the liability will be settled with credit or cash. So there is a view that, okay, whatever the liability the auditor is assessing, it can be paid through credit also. Why the liable DRC03 to be paid in cash? Again, in my personal view, it has to be paid in cash only. See, you cannot take a credit of today's date to settle a liability of the past period. you know, we know under GST that first liability is always set off with the credit and balance we paid with the cash. Today I have a balance in credit ledger. Now this credit is what I have acquired today. The credit which I have acquired today, I cannot use it for my past dated liability. For a simple, let me give you a simple example. Every month I have a liability of say 10,000 rupees and 8,000 rupees is my input tax credit. I have 10,000 liability, 8,000 input tax credit. 2,000 is a liability to be paid in cash. In month 2, I have made an extra purchases. I have made an extra purchases and 12,000 has become my input tax credit. Can I in month 1 not report the liability, make it as 10,000 instead of 10,000 zero, 8,000 input tax credit, or that also I forgot, both reported 3B nil. In month 2 when I am coming, I am reporting 10,000 of previous month and 10,000 of current month as 20,000 liability. 8,000 input tax credit of previous month and 12,000 input tax credit of current month, and net it off and pay it in input tax credit only. In my personal view, that is not a right method. So whatever the liability of the previous period which needs to be paid, if there is a credit balance which is carried forward till date, you definitely can do it. Otherwise, you have to pay it through cash only. Only when a credit for that period, it is still there. Like you have a transition credit which you have taken and it is not a valid credit. That credit is still lying in your trans credit, electronic credit ledger. Definitely you can pay it through credit. But otherwise, any liability arising on account of annual return and the audit, liability has to be paid in cash only. Please make note of that. Next points on the validation of the turnover is credits which are not taken, it cannot be utilized in the annual return, which I have said. And every month is a tax period, so check the interest on a monthly basis and liability to be paid in the cash. We have discussed this. Now, validating the exemptions. Very important, when you are validating the turnover, you also validate exemptions, which is there in Table 7. Each item of the validation, please take the notification reference 2/2017 and 12/2017. Up to date, time to time, it is verified. Every notification has a condition. Every exemption has a condition. All those conditions which are there in the exemption has to be fulfilled to claim a condition to exemption. If even one condition is failed, you cannot take the benefit of that exemption. So you have to make sure whether you have sufficient documentation to prove it has been taken care of. And sometimes there is a change in rate of tax. See, originally it was notified as exempt, you know, but later the rate schedule got amended and became taxable. So you have to pay attention to it. So you have to do some research whether there is any change happened. Very importantly, please do an input output ratio or a margin analysis. Take a simple example, pharmacy, pharma industry. Some medicines are exempt, some are taxable, life-saving drugs taxable at 5%. Majority of them taxable at 12%. They also sell non-medicinal items which are at 18%, various category. They are purchasing, they have inputs. Now, the accounting may not give you a correlation how much of 18% purchase you will not get a clarity classification. But primarily, you do a broad categorization. Purchases without tax, this is like exempt purchases, broad medicines, sales without the tax, exempted sales. Look at the profit margin. Look at that input output ratio, or look at that margin vis-a-vis the margin which is there in other categories. Look at what is the margin which is there in other categories. Is this margin sufficient available, or exempted category has a higher margin, which means some of the taxable sales are getting pushed. Some of the taxable sales are getting pushed into that. Now, the basis you may take in doing so might be 2A. The argument the client would come up is, in the end of the month, I have lot of exempted goods related purchases. So please do not go by pure purchases. Look at the consumption. Fine, build that closing stock workings and build the consumption ratio, make sure that your exempted sales are matching. And in table 7, not just your exempted, you also report the transactions which do not attract tax, which is equivalent to table 5 of GSTR 9. Classic thing, zero rated supplies, exports made without payment of tax. Please check whether LUT has been executed or not. Now, LUT is a procedural document. If LUT is not there, would it change from exports without tax to export with payment of tax? In my view, no. And we also have a backing of circular 37 in para 3.2. They have given saying that give some relaxation, allow them to take LUT at a later point. It is a procedural valid issue which has been gone up. But not just that, export has multiple conditions. If I have raised an invoice within 3 months, I have to send the goods, or I have to realize the export proceeds within 1 year. So you have to check all other conditions, have they been fulfilled or not. And especially we have to, when it comes to the services, please take cognizance of section 12 subsection 3 to 14, 13 subsection 3 to 13, where the place of supply plays an important role. Any item which is there in 12, most likely a domestic transaction. But every item in 13 is not an export transaction. Every item in section 13 is not an export transaction. In fact, this morning we were having casual discussion on the notification which came under 13 49 14/2019 on the pharmacy related research and development, where they have said the place of supply it to be treated as outside India. The moot question that came up is, in case of a pharma research, the someone in the foreign party asking you to do a molecular formulation and give some result thing, wouldn't it fit under 13.2? Is it under 13.3 and the place of supply is in India? Maybe the department's view could be it is in 13.3 and the place of supply is in India. So not that every export transaction is a zero rated supply. Especially I notice intermediary transaction errors happen. A lot of these hotels, they where a foreign person comes and stays in the hotel in India, he pays in the dollar, treating those transactions as export. Please do not think that any transaction which is to a foreign party means an export. You got to take cognizance of it. And whenever the goods have been sent to an SEZ, there should be endorsements made to the by the SEZ officer. An SEZ officer has to endorse that, yes, okay, these goods have received. Only then you can treat it as zero rated without payment of tax. So you have to definitely necessarily do a lot of audits in validating the turnover and exemptions. Moving to the next part of the issues which I have mentioned is, and issues which are arising basis the industry or basis the nature of an accounting. I have picked few industries. Typical industries, real estate industry, or someone with a long-term contract, or someone who is doing a principal agent transaction, and someone who has job work activities. Right? Let's look at the first point, the transactions. Now, whenever these industries, when you are looking at, you got to go beyond P&L. Real estate industry, anything which you see in the P&L as income has got nothing to do with your 9C, because the revenue is recognized accounting standard for contracts, percentage completion contracts, AS9, Ind AS, whatever the IFRS. Okay, I'm not an expert in percentage completion method. So is that for GST? Absolutely no. In GST, we go by time of supply, which is mentioned under section 13. As far as I know, and wherever I have noticed, most of the companies under the in this industry have paid the taxes purely based on bank collection. Their ability to collect whatever collected, they are paying GST. Is that what the law says? Again, that is no. Law says the time of supply is demand raised. So you got to list of the contracts entered with the customer. What is the demand due as per the time slab of that? Whatever is the demand due as per the time slab of that is what you have to list it. Once the demand due is listed as per the time slab of it, that whether or not realization doesn't matter. The moment it is due, you got to raise the GST invoice and pay discharge the duty. Same happens with a long-term contract. Now, I undertake a long-term contract in terms of construction of a site, you erecting a machinery, or I'm building or manufacturing something, a case-to-case specific made to order. Now, in these cases, you also got to look whether it is a supply of goods or supply of services. In case it is a works contract, very thin line, it might become a works contract, or is it a machinery which you are building? And if it is of a works contract in nature, then you got to ascertain from the contract, because it is a continuous supply of service, ascertain the time of supply from the contract. That's very important. Then principal and agent transaction. In my view, this has been substantially taken care, but definitely in the year one, I have noticed errors from lot of the people. I will give one small example of take a case of Airtel prepaid dealer. Now, this guy gets a commission of one rupee. So 100 rupees currency tops up, he gets 1 rupee. Now, hypothetically, during the year, he has topped up a currency worth 3 crores. Currency worth 3 crores, he has topped up. What does it mean? Someone comes to his shop, they pay him cash and he tops up. Most of the time, they also do a transfer through Google Pay, and it is automatically debited. Now, in his income tax P&L, he might even not even reported to income tax. Less than 5 lakhs, no income tax, not paid. 3 crores, 3 lakhs is what his revenue is. And he considers himself as a small dealer, and he is a small dealer. But unfortunately, when it comes to the GST, entire 3 crores is supply. 18% of the 3 crores is his liability. All that he know, 100 rupees he received, he did a top up, customer got some 80 rupees. He doesn't know the math of it. He keeps 1 rupee, 99 rupees, Airtel takes it. But 3 years later, when department comes for the audit, he end up paying 18% of 3 crores, which is a huge sum of 54 lakhs. And he may say, okay, I might have input tax credit. Why don't we adjust? My net income is only 3 lakhs. I should be end up paying only 54,000. Unfortunately, that wouldn't be the case. He would be paying the liability and he will be losing the credit. This is one value addition you can do. Now, those who are exclusively doing principal and agent, you will definitely get. But unfortunately, where we miss out, company is doing a lot of transaction, and there is one small element of principal agent transaction for one small vertical, one small line of business. These transactions would be rooted in the P&L as transaction in money. It didn't even come to P&L, so it went to balance sheet. So it came in one side as current liabilities and it got offset. So when this happens, you don't even know. So how do we deal with it is very important. Next, we know from section 143, read with again section 19, goods sent to the job worker, it should be received within 1 year. Now, if it doesn't come, it becomes a supply. We are nearing 3 years of GST. So there are insufficient record keeping, or the ITC 04 compliance is very poor. In these situations, you also have to ascertain, though technically nothing is there in the P&L, no transactions. So you are now have to go beyond the books and check wherever there is a manufacturing activity. Have you checked whether the goods have come within period or not? Now, all these which I am saying are giving you an indicative checklist. Please note that I am not saying that, okay, this if you do this, your life is taken care of. No, I am giving you as many as scenarios as that can come up, because you have already encountered an audit once. Now it's a time, it's a wake-up call that we now need to go beyond and check, like, what are the things. Next, related party transactions. Please refer to the financial statement notes to accounts, look at the related party transaction, ask for those related party transaction and check for the valuation. Especially inter-unit transfers, what is the value at which they have transferred? Transactions with the directors, transactions with the group companies, look at that. And there are some important advance rulings which have come, and there is a casual statement which people say, it is, these are not advance rulings, they are adverse ruling, because that's the kind of impact that would cause. Some of the advance rulings says that, okay, charge the employees of one unit who are serving to other unit also. Now that is a personal call, I would leave it to you how you would want to take it, but look at the situation where there is one group CFO. Many of your clients have 1, 3, 4 entities sitting in one building, one accountant, one director or one CFO doing all the works. Would there be not a cross charge for these things? Definitely there should be a cross charge. Make sure that those things have been taken care and you provide for it. Read the contingent liabilities which have been recorded. Read the internal financial control document which they have recorded. Read the observations made by the auditor in the CARO and read the expenditures and income in the foreign currency. Again, when you read the expenditures in, and incomes in foreign currency, you will definitely get to see, is there any reverse charge liability which they have missed out? Especially import of services, the JV they have booked for payment to be made to my parent head office outside India, some know-how charges, all those comes under reverse charge liability. Not just the outward related, reverse charge also to be focused. Next, there is some complexities in accounting. What are the complexities? The credit note received from supplier. He says there is no tax, so I will not reverse input tax credit. And there is no supply because it is not from customer. I received it from supplier. So it is a non-GST transaction. No, it is definitely not a non-GST transaction. Please be careful about it. Sometimes sales accounts, returns are accounted as purchase. Credit purchase returns are accounted as sales. Typical some of the accountant's errors. Bad debts netted off with the sales. Bad debts are netted off with the sales. How do you ensure that the sales, the credit notes which are issued are not in the nature of bad debts? The discounts which are issued in the name of credit notes, not in the nature of bad debts. So how do you take credit of, how do you take control of that? Whatever is there in credit side of P&L, you can audit. But credit side of expenditure, whole lot of purchase register dump, some negative items. What are those negative items? So you got to again extract. So those who are experts with the system, you can put a query and extract that. If what are the other items? But otherwise, you got to definitely look at if an expenditure item has been credited, see whether it is any reimbursement. And seldom a reimbursement will be of Rule 33, a pure agent, especially an auditor's reimbursement bill, OPE, my travel, food, stay, which I'm charging to the client, all that are taxable. 90% of reimbursement expenses are taxable, so be careful. Then you also have an obligation like input tax credit with section 12 or 14 or the rate of tax liability matching what is there in the books. Sometimes the client might have an accounting as detailed as 5% SGST, 2.5% SGST, 2.5% CGST, all output ledgers, all input ledgers to the extreme end. One GST ledger, payable, receivable, input, output, CGST, SGST, IGST, everything matching, put in, packed in there. Amongst all this, you carve out how, what is the real credit, real liability, match it, your liability with your table 9, match your credit with the table 14 and see whether it is matching or not. Very challenging. Please do it. Next, advances received from the customer vis-a-vis billing. Within the same customer, if there is an advance received and there is a billing outstanding and it is netted off, difficult to do, but please take a cognizance of it and do it. Then incomplete accounting. So if the vendor accounts are not done bill-wise, you will have an issue. Or unbilled revenue to the sales, if they did not do a mapping of which of the unbilled revenue which got billed subsequently, which did not get billed subsequently. You know, unbilled revenue, especially for service industry, you will find logical end of the month they recognize revenue, but within 30 days they should have raised the invoice. So if they are not raising the invoice, you still have to recognize it as a revenue. You cannot eternally carry forward it as unbilled revenue. See by when it got billed, otherwise the time of supply happens, the invoice should get raised. So goods sent to the job worker, we have discussed goods sent on consignment. Again, the closing stock which is there in the books of accounts, do a physical verification. Does it really exist, or is it sitting at a customer place or a consignment place? With 31 subsection says, 7 says, within 6 months the material should come back. Has the material has received or not? And the transactions which are apparently not available are barter transactions, schedule 1 transactions, and the liability on account of the inward supplies which have come from composition dealer, definitely not an issue. Other than that, if there are any inward supplies, see, generally when you have a purchase, two types you segregate: purchase with tax, purchase without tax. With the tax, we only check for eligibility, no issue. Purchase without tax, is it an exempt purchase? Is it purchased from a composition dealer? Is it purchased from an unregistered dealer? If it is not three, then it has a reverse charge liability. So leaving exempt purchase, leaving composition dealer purchase, it has a reverse charge liability. So just please check what type of these purchases are and whether the RCM liability has been properly taken care or not taken care. And as I'm saying, please build your own checklist. The institute guidance note has a beautiful checklist. You can go with it, but the advantage of attending the webinars, certain things will strike. Okay, these are the things I'm missing out during my audits. Make a note of it. Make note, build your own checklist and reconciliations. Next, whenever which are the transactions with SEZ, the transactions with SEZ, check whether the endorsement of the SEZ officer is there or not. The common mistake which I am seeing in SEZ supplies are the taxes are collected and again refunds are also claimed. Taxes are collected and refunds are also claimed. Continuing with the same example, say I am in the pharma industry. I have set up a pharmacy in a SEZ location. All the custom in an SEZ unit, and with a corporate I have tie up. So employees of that corporate come to my pharmacy and buy medicines and go. End of the month, I raise an invoice to SEZ. I raise based on the MRP. Now any product which is MRP is inclusive of taxes. So I have already collected the taxes from SEZ, which is a zero rated supply, and this I will be reporting as with payment of tax in my returns, and I will be going ahead and claiming the refund. So it is like unjust enrichment. So I am getting a double benefit of the taxes. One side I am getting it from government, and one side I am getting from the SEZ. This is one thing which I have commonly noticed. So supplies to SEZ on MRP should not be claimed as a refund. As an auditor, you have to claim, you have to make it as an additional liability. Next, refer to the tax audit report. By now, tax audits are also over. Refer to the tax audit report. Look at the stock register. What are the comments which they have made? Very important. Personal expenses debited, very important. Now, 14A disclosure and 27A. Thankfully, the certain breakup of the GST has been deferred to the again next financial year. But in case of a non-tax audit company cases, the breakup of GST expenditure is required. So this would all be helpful in tomorrow's session. I thought I'll just put it in the sequence. So all this expenditure is related to check the classification of your input tax credit related. Some miscellaneous items flowing from the accounting is the valuation adjustment. So whenever you are doing a valuation adjustment, this value is beyond what is there in the P&L. Like an air travel agent. Air travel agent would have recognized the entire ticket amount, everything as its revenue. But the taxable value for the purpose of GST is only 5%, 10%, whatever the valuation rules which said on the deemed commission. Forex. So whenever you are adopting the valuation rules, there is a difference in the value. So you have to have the workings in your GST or 9C that these are beyond my books of accounts, these valuation adjustments have done. Now, the non-GST receipts, whichever you are classifying as non-GST, you got to make an affirmative stand that yes, this is a non-GST. One important point at this point I would like to make, the difference between 5O and 5R in 9C. If you are reporting anything under 5O, like I arrived, my turnover according to me is 1 crore, turnover according to client is 98 lakhs. Now in 5O, I put minus 2 lakhs, so it comes to 98, both matches, no issues. Or I write it as 100, I write 5O as 0, bring it to 5R, 2 lakhs, and explain the difference there. How do you distinguish what to report in 5O and what to report in 5R? If you notice, between 5A to 5O, there are list of items which have been given to report. If you find there is something which is in the same line of it, but did not find it as an additional thing, put it in 5O. Invoice raised in advance. Now, that invoice is there, but revenue is not recognized because income did not accrue. I've just raised it. So you have to do an adjustment. You do not find anywhere there. Park it in 5O, no issues. But something when income itself is missing, you can put it in 5O. It has to come in 5R. So you got to be very careful in choosing what comes between 5O and 5R. Next, the data which is not matching with VAT and service tax returns. Last year, 2017-18, many people wouldn't have paid attention between April to June, and the whatever which has been given carved out P&L has been taken. So very important, the opening and closing balances are very important. So in your 9C of last year, you have reported something as opening unbilled revenue, opening advances, and closing unbilled revenue, closing advances. Now VAT audits happening, service tax audits happening, something you realized that, okay, there was an error in the last year, this so much belongs to VAT, and you now make an adjustment. Owing to that, you cannot come to the current year 9C and change the opening balance again, saying that there was an error in the previous year 9C, definitely no. Take care of it. Expenses liable to RCM generally not tracked. I said, take a look at it. Sale of an asset, look at the depreciation schedule. Ensure yourself that there is no sale of an asset. If something, an asset which has been sold for loss, you don't even find in the P&L. Or if it is sold at the book value, you don't find it. You got to look at the detailed depreciation schedule. See if there is any movement outward in the gross block of the asset or the accumulated depreciation. Look that, okay, there is an asset which has been sold, or read the cash flow statement, cash from investment activity, if there is any proceeds which has been realized, take that basis and create a liability. Transactions not recorded in the books, you have to go by industry, what type of industry, and go with it. Now, what are the issues? We have moved almost to the end. What are the issues that arise from the record keeping? The issues that would arise from the record keeping is segregation. Now, any of credits would be dealt in detail by the faculty tomorrow. The eligible versus ineligible segregation of the type of credits. Next thing, records that not maintained at each place of business. Now, if you read section 35, read with rule 56, books of accounts have to be there at each place of business, relevant to that place of business. And if there is a principal place of business, principal place of business should have all the records. So in a state, if I have 35 branches, each branch should have records of that branch. In my principal place, I should have all the 35 branches together. It should be there in the principal place. In your audit, you have to see if any of the place of business is not recorded. If a place of business is not recorded, what would be the issue? The issue that would come up is you are moving the goods from your head office to a branch which is not registered. If it is not registered, then it is not your branch and it is not a delivery challan transaction, it is a supply. It's a supply. Any premises which is not registered, a stock which is lying there, will be deemed as a supply. You got to make sure you give a comment to it and bring an attention saying that this is a liability. If you cannot quantify, you please qualify. Now, how do you identify a transaction treatment? If the auditor and the SSC is accepting for it, well and good, audit client wants to pay 9 DRC03 annual return, pay for it. Client is not accepting, you are clear it is a liability. Qualify in part 5. You put it in part 5. You know that there is a liability, but you cannot qualify owing to volume of transaction or you have a doubt. Put it as a qualification in your report saying that this is the nature of transaction, it needs to be qualified. I've just listed 3-4 illustrative things in your certificate which you need to write, but qualify it. Next thing is track the tariff rate change. There is a change in the rate of tariff for most of the products, especially in FMCG. So whenever there is a change in rate of tax, we have section 14 giving how do we apply the rate. So while computing the tax liability, take cognizance of the rate of tax and apply the rate properly. If there is any missing information in the stock register, highlight them and qualify. We have three different types of qualification and one of it is record keeping. So the books of accounts are complete or not, please give a qualification. So yeah, one couple of more. Invoicing, if there are any unsigned invoices or if the self-tax invoice is missing. Again, this is something which we notice that self-tax invoice is not generated. End of the year, they can at least look at, okay, these are the invoices for which I have reverse charge liability. Let a self-tax invoice be created. If not, it has to be created, reported as an additional point. Receipt vouchers not maintained, missing information in table 13 of GSTR1, non-execution of LUT. Please report all of this. Anything which you see an anomaly in compliance with the law. That is where if you see 2 subsection 13, the last point, not just the examination of turnover, output liability, input tax credit, refund, it is compliance with other aspects of the law also. If that compliance is not there or compliance is poor, please report that transaction. Missing data and controls in the audit is, if there are any missing controls in the audit, you report that and have an audit trail in the edited entries. Do a reconciliation with the electronic ledgers. If they have multiple softwares and they are not integrated, you make sure how you are building audit controls. These are definitely covered in your preamble document. Prepare a preamble document for each client. Now, basis all this, you got to give a general notes to the annual audit. Have an engagement letter with the auditee. Before start of this, give these are my expectations. This is what you have to do. During the course of audit, whatever you didn't know, like an HSN has been classified as 8305. You don't know whether it is 8305 or not. You're not an expert. You record this is what your classification. But he says 8305. You have an obligation to check what is the tariff for 8305. Check for it. Check the recent updates which are happening. You attend the webinars. Update yourself with the provisions of the law. Make sure not just you attend, your staff is also trained and equipped. And especially during the lockdown period, one work which can be done sitting at home is GSTR 9 and 9C, because what we are doing is for the period 18-19 income tax returns are filed in the books of accounts, are his tally data. Client can download from his mails and email it. The financial statements can be downloaded from ROC sites and income tax website and can be emailed. 2A, 3B, 1 can be downloaded. Everything is cloud. Start using some technology. Use a proper software and start building your working papers. And 90% of the work can be done before the lockdown is lifted. We can do a good amount of job. You can do an initial discussion and conclusion over the email. Things can be done. Please make effective use of it. Wherever you have disagreement, wherever you have disagreements, you make comments under books of account section with regard to adhering to the rule 46 and rule 55. If there is a disagreement, quantification in 9C part A, quantification in 9C part A. You cannot quantify, qualify it in part B. You can't even qualify, you, it has something, it's like you yourself are confused and you are more likely you agree with the view of the SSE, then put it as a confirmation in the MRL from the client. And bring attention that the branches which are not registered or which are not audited, which are not in your purview, bring attention to it. I had a session 2 days back on the same topic, but of course it was an upsell. One question which came up, that is GST auditor has a liability to do check with 2A, is a credit there in 2A or not? In my personal view, definitely you have to look at it. And especially when 8D is, 8D has a huge value, which means you have huge negative coming up saying that you have claimed extra so much. You have to pay an attention whether really that something like that exists or not, right? So these are the various things that needs to be taken into account. And the session has to be completed by 6:30. And I've been told by 6:15 if I wind up and we can take some of the Q&A. So I'm sure some of you might have some questions. And I now hand it over to the organizers to take some of the questions which have come. Some might be repeated, something would have been answered. Whatever the questions which has come, we can take a look at them now.
Yes, Venubhai. Yeah. Thank you so much for deliberating your experience. And as you have discussed with me that you have started completing and filing GSTR 9C for 18-19. So many compliments for that. And also you have given us a motivation to use this period and make it unlock for GST 9C audit season. Now the questions before us are, first is, we have sold goods on 15 July 2018, financial year 18-19, and against that we have issued credit note on 15 August 2019, that is in financial year 19-20. We have reported credit note in 3B and GSTR 1 in the month of August 2019. Now, please suggest how to report the same in GSTR 9. Either it should be reported in 18-19 or 19-20 or both. Yeah. Yes, Venu sir.
So this confusion got created because of the documentation error in the table 5, how it has been reported by 9C. But in my personal view, definitely this is a transaction of 19-20. I made a supply in July 2018. It is a liability in 2018. Now goods completely got returned to me in 1920. Now in 1819, can I show the report transaction as zero? Answer is no. In 1819, you have to show the 100 rupees sold in 1819 as a liability. 1920, you have received back. In 1920 audit, you have to reduce this as a credit note. Next question.
Yes.
Okay. Are foreign currency forwards gain to be included in turnover in 9C as well? Sir, if you look at the foreign currency forward gains, I am presuming, okay, you are not a dealer of the forex, but you did some hedging transactions against your receivable or payable, and owing to that you made some gain. Now, should this be reported? Answer is yes. You got to report everything which is there in your P&L, in your 9C, in your table 5. Get your the top level turnover. After getting it, you exclude this forex transaction because it is not a supply. It has been, it is a derived transaction. You can exclude it in table 7, but definitely it has to be included in your aggregate turnover. Next question.
Yes. If you can take.
The more clarification required for credit note and financial credit note. Mobile distributor sold handsets below the purchase price and he received balance amount in front of the price drop amount. How this price drop amount is to be considered, whether it can be considered as a financial credit note or GST not applicable on it?
Yeah, if you read to section 15 valuation, 15 subsection 2, it says additions to the price. And one of the point is the consideration received by a third party. Whenever I am selling this mobile phone at a lower price, why am I selling? I am in the business of making money. Why will I do loss? I am willing to sell it at a lower price because my dealer or my distributor said I will do a price support. You definitely got to add the price support and discharge the tax. One other error it is happening. This price support is treated, this price support is treated as a business auxiliary support and remitted as a miscellaneous income at the rate of 18%. Answer is no. Especially this car traders and the cement industry, the rate of tax of the original product is 28%. In car, it is cess is also there. So you got to pay the full amount, original rate of tax and the cess amount. In case of mobile, earlier it was at 12%. You discharge at 12%. Now the rate has become 18%. But yes, this, even though it is a financial credit note, even though you reduce it from your purchase as your cost, or your, the distributor itself is offsetting in the bill and saying taking a lower price, GST liability is there and you have to pay for it. Please make a special audit. If you do audit assessment now and get that taxes paid, better. Later when the department comes, they would always say that, okay, it is suppression of the fact. They will treat it as a fraud. 100% it will be liability if they don't pay within time, and interest, all those issues would come up.
Here I would like to add that when the transaction is the same, manufacturer or in this situation, from where I have purchased the mobile phone, he is reducing his prices. So in service tax regime, we have a situation where they said that it's a transaction same supply, and since you have reduced the price of purchase, either you are required to reverse credit at that time, or definitely you have to pay GST on the sale. If you have not reduced, then I guess there is no need to pay. Definitely it's another view, but there is some interpretation issue is going on.
Yeah, in support since it's a credit note, I am making a presumption that the supplier did not charge GST and the dealer did not reduce input tax credit. As Bishan Bhai mentioned, if I'm reducing my input tax credit, then it is not a supply. See, technically, it has to be linked to the original rate of tax of the product. So if it is 100 rupees ITC, I reduce my ITC or pay it as an output liability. Now the question comes is, will there be a double taxation? Definitely courts will take a cognizance. If you take one action, it is fine. The worst, I have treated as a financial credit note. Since the supplier did not charge GST in it, I am not reducing any liability, nor I am paying any tax. That is a wrong way of treating a transaction.
In same support with Bishan Bhai, the government issued the circular of 9211, I think. Correct. That was also withdrawn later on by them, that it should not be charged.
Yes. The next question is, even though instructions from the government are clear that the tax discovered to be paid while filing annual return are to be paid in cash only, or as said by sir, my credit balance standing today, if it is being carried forward from the year under audit, can we still now pay that tax by current credit balance? Have overstepped their jurisdiction by compelling us to pay tax in cash when the act states that the tax payment includes payment by tax as well as by ITC. Can we not first file GSTR 9, make payment with ITC if available, and then file GSTR 9C to avoid tax payment in cash?
My view, GSTR 9, the additional liability coming in DRC 03, has to be paid through cash only. In what situation you can pay it through credit? If that credit is coming as an opening balance of that period, it is still carried forward till date, you can pay it through credit. Otherwise, it has to be paid in cash only.
So, Venubhai, if before filing GSTR 9, we discharge the liability through DRC 03, then what will be the scenario?
No, even the DRC 03 also should be paid through cash, unless otherwise it is an opening balance. If let's take a simple example, 2018-19, March 2019, electronic credit ledger balance is zero. And I have now discovered a liability for 18-19. Had this liability, if I have reported in 18-19, would I have not been paying it in cash? Definitely I would have been paying in cash. Given that I am adding that liability now, I cannot use a credit which is arising now. In March 20 credit, I cannot use it to pay a liability of March 19. So it has to be paid in cash.
Okay. Next.
Next is how to treat the return of credit sundry creditors with regard to the reversal of ITC or any other aspect to be considered.
Yeah, so I will be taking two categories of creditors. Creditors during GST period, creditors prior to GST period. In either case, there is no supply. A creditors during GST period, definitely you have reversed the input tax credit for non-paying within 180 days. A creditors before GST period, there is no implication of ITC reversal. In either case, the supply do not arise. It is outside the purview of GST.
Sir, next question is, there any way that we can get back our GST back in case of bad debts? Is there any provision in this case? So for the bad debts he is talking, can they file a refund, or how this amount which has been paid can be recovered from the government?
Whomsoever asked the question, I can understand the pain. Unfortunately, the answer is no. Now, is there a provision in this case? I would suggest only this method of recording transaction is issuing a pro forma invoice whenever the supply do not happen. See, especially in case of a service industry, you issue an invoice saying that, okay, this is my bill. Now, looking at bill, client doesn't come. Right, so or after taking the service, he says, no, I cannot pay this, I will only pay you so much. Or after 1 year, he says, no, I cannot pay. So maybe you start having a practice, if it is not agreed in advance, you want to give an estimate and a quotation. But once invoice is raised, payment not received, bad debts cannot be, there is no provision out.
In audited turnover, do I need to consider whole credit side of profit and loss account, or unreconciled turnover will come when compared to GSTR 9, or do I need to mention in table number 5O and write the reason in table number 6?
Yeah. If firstly, do I need to consider? You have to consider all the credits in the P&L. All right. Whether they are reported in 9 or not, you have to consider. Do I need to mention in table 5O? I have said, how do you choose between 5O and 5R? I have given the governing principles. And if you are reporting anything under 5O, nothing will come under 6. Just because I am saying that nothing will come under 6, you cannot put everything under 5O. you got to choose what comes between 5O or 5R.
So the next question is whether GST is payable on financial credit note like issued in auto sector for sales promotion or sales target.
Yeah, so when I say sales target, I'm treating it as purchase target. I am expected to lift so much material and I will be given a discount. In those situations, I got a bulk discount. There is no supply, no GST. Leaving this aspect, all other types of financial credit notes will have a liability. So please ascertain what type of credit note you have received.
I have 16 branches all across the India. Is pen-based turnover is to be considered? So I am liable to be audited for wash for all branches. Even my turnover is below 5 crore for single branch. Limit for 18-19 audit. So in table number 5A of the 9C, when auditor turnover is to be mentioned for a particular branch 9C, do I need to mention the consolidated turnover of the all the entity as a whole, or have to mention for a particular branch? If as a whole entity's turnover, then where to mention the unreconciled amount?
Yeah, sir, this issue is there. You do not have a place to do a reconciliation of PAN-based turnover to GST and ID-based turnover. You have to split, you carve out the financials for the GST and ID, and the GST and ID of that branch, the P&L, you have to start the turnover. And even though a branch has turnover of 5 lakhs, whole PAN exceeded 5 crores, but that PAN has 5 lakhs, you still have to do a 9C for that branch. So if the PAN-based turnover exceeded 5 crores, you have to do audit of each GST and ID in that PAN. 9C has to be submitted. Lastly, only for the financial year 18-19, the limit has been extended to 5 crores. Otherwise, limit for GST audit is still 2 crores. Next question.
Yes, sir. And whoever asked this question, I am thankful to him, because in our guidance note, Venuji has written this chapter for multiple GSTN, and he has clarified it very nicely. Next is, Venubhai, can input credit be taken in respect of expenses which have been recovered from related parties in case of export, or the expenses to be shown as export?
Okay, question is little not clear. I'll make it this way. Can an input tax credit in respect of expenses which have been recovered from the related parties in case of export, or the expenses to be shown as export? Now, firstly, out of syllabus question, I have to only deal liability, but you are asking input tax credit. I don't want to jump into others' view. But, sir, if anything for you to claim as an input tax credit, has to be a business expenditure. How will it become business expenditure? You are recording it as an expenditure in your business books. Once you are recording as an expenditure in your business books, it also necessarily the bill should be in your name. Now, let's take the example of my auditor's OPE reimbursement. Auditor has stayed in a hotel. The hotel bill cannot be treated as my input tax credit. The auditor's bill should be treated as the input tax credit. Now we have linked this question to in case of export. I am thinking owing to export, some recovery charges you are doing, maybe CHA or the other expenditure you are claiming. Yes, you definitely can take a credit whenever it is related to a taxable supply, zero rated supply, everything you can take credit of.
The next is audit report on income tax and ROC. Can I upload the provisional balance sheet and P&L in GST, as still accounts will take time to finalize?
Sir, we are now talking about 2018-19. Income tax is done. ROC is done. Now we are in 2020-21. So some of the clients have finalized 19-20. So definitely we will not come up with this issue. In case if this issue comes up, you will choose part B of the certificate saying that it is unaudited. Someone has an unaudited number, you can take that as a basis. But we will never get into this issue.
So next is interest on income tax provisions written by Ind AS adjustment, deferred tax credit shall be the part of turnover or not?
Yeah, sir, in my view, I would recommend, personal recommendation, take it in as a part of the turnover, eliminate as non-GST supplies. Because if you notice, whenever department or someone comes for audit, they just compare, okay, this is the number in the audited financial, is that matching or not? Better let that match. Now, once that matches, then you take it to 5A, reduce it from 7 as non-GST supply, so that you have a control of whether your start point is correct or not. Otherwise, you will be worrying, okay, from where did I get this number, which is not there in the P&L account.
5A turnover is always missed to that we have considered.
Preferably do it. There is no guiding, there is no law, but preferably do it. Good for you. No definition for 5A turnover. You are the author of 9C.
So the question is, one of my party works in two states and they transfer goods from one unit in one state to another. Should the transfer be shown in 5D, that is deemed supply, or 5O, other adjustments?
It is a Schedule 1 transaction. Please 5O keep as minimal as possible. Show it as a deemed supply.
Isn't RCM on purchase from unregistered person suspended? And list of item on which RCM applicable is not specified.
Yeah, very true. RCM from unregistered persons is suspended only to the extent of 9 subsection 4. But in 9 subsection 3, if you are still purchasing from an unregistered person in 9(3), is liable. For example, you are getting an opinion from a lawyer and that lawyer is not registered. You still have to pay reverse charge under 9 subsection 3. 9(4) is suspended only for other than 9(3) transaction. Right now, 9(4) is applicable only one class of industry, which is real estate sector.
One of my client has policy to put in books in next month. 3B ITC credit of March 19 month. Some entries in books are passed in April 19. What to do?
Prepare a reconciliation statement.
That's it.
Thank you. I should definitely.
So, sir, we have
Ahmedabad branch. Bishan Bhai, especially for considering me and inviting me, though literally not there in front of you, but I'm always, it would be my pleasure, love to be meeting the participants of Ahmedabad branch, and lot of love to Bishan Bhai and the organizing committee, Rahul ji and Sinal ji, the chairman, everyone. So I should definitely thank you first for giving an opportunity. So over to you, organizers.
Sir, it's your generosity, we are, and your humbleness. We at Ahmedabad branch and all other branches of Gujarat are very much thankful to you for showering your love and knowledge to all of us. And I'm thankful to all the participants for participating and posting your questions to the authority, I can say, for the GST audit, a technological person and a contributor to Indirect Taxes Committee of Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. Venubhai, thank you very much. And we are closing this webinar here. If there are any questions, rest, we will take it in the next session, or we can forward it to Venuji, and I'm sure that we are going to get answer from him. So thank you very much, everyone. We are closing this webinar. Thank you. I request.